Yay.
Think we are live now.
Yeah, live.
Okay, cool. Well, thank you everyone for being here. We're about to start the panel. I think, maybe what we should do is just like wait for a little bit to see if there's like people tuning in. Which I guess we can honestly just start. Cool. Yeah. You can go ahead. It's going to be posted anyways, and people can rewatch it. Awesome. Thank you so much for everyone to be here. So we can start the panel. Sorry about that. Yeah, so this is the first panel for the event that we put together, Black Men Living Month. So we created this event to kind of like have a platform where we talk about experiences, our experiences as like Black trans people, especially considering the fact that a lot of times our voices are relegated to kind of like a backdrop or an afterthought or just never considered at all. So that's why we kind of like went ahead and created this like series of panels. And we're really thankful for all our panelists here today. So we have Lynx, Raven, River, and Cyrus, who we are very thankful to have here tonight. My name is Kim. I'm a multimedia artist. I am a performance artist. I do visuals. I do all kinds of different things. And I also I also do activism through art. And yeah, I think that kind of sums it up. Do you want to introduce yourself for a bit, Leroy?
Sure, I'm Leroy. I'm an educator and a parent and a community organizer for Black Lives Matter Toronto, and do work around combating anti-Black racism in Toronto.
Perfect. So I think we can kind of like pass it to our panelists, so whoever wants to go first and introduce themselves real quick for our viewers, you can go ahead.
Hi, everyone. Okay, I'll go first. My name is Raven Wings. I am an African Bermudian queer trans person currently living in Toronto. I guess I can describe myself as an empowerment movement storyteller. I work very hard to increase representation of queer and trans people of color within dance and mainstream media. I've done a lot of work around disability justice in terms of accessibility to dance programming and through like harm reduction. I'm also a member of Black Lives Matter Toronto, which is really exciting. And so as one of these artists who was doing activism through my art, right now I'm doing activism through my art as well as in the streets. That's me.
I can go next. So, hey everyone, I'm Lynx. I go by the name Lynx St. Marie after Black Poet. I am a multimedia artist, activist, educator. I brand and organization, which is currently on hiatus, called Career of Gender. And it's a grassroots organization and transnational visibility project, and it celebrates Black Indigenous people of color who are LGBTQ+, and all the ways that we celebrate gender in our stories. I'm a community builder. I'm really passionate about Black liberation and healing justice and disability justice. I identify as a disabled, chronically ill, non-binary, gender-fluid person. I'm an artist. So.
So whoever who's next can go ahead.
I can go next. My name is Cyrus Marcus Ware. I'm a visual artist, an activist, a scholar, a curator, identical twin, and a parent. I make art mostly in the mediums of drawing, painting, and performance, that largely in the last 5 or 6 years has focused on exploring activist culture and how we can kind of support and help each other to sustain our own lives as a way of sustaining our movement building. I'm a scholar. I'm doing a PhD at York, and I teach a course on prison abolition. I've been an abolitionist for many years, and about 15 years ago helped to start the Prison Justice Action Committee, which was an abolitionist organization that used art-based techniques to talk about prison abolition in Toronto and beyond. I'm really involved in disability justice organizing. I'm a disabled artist. I'm here in Treaty 7 territory right now, and at the Banff Center, co-leading a workshop for the weekend on disability arts practices and performance. And I curate exhibitions that largely try to bring together artists who are thinking critically about some complex questions around intersectionality. And the ways that our identities get to exist together. And so I like to bring together artists who don't always get to be shown to have great conversations about the kind of world that we want to live in. Thanks.
Hi, I'm River. Can you hear me? Okay, good. So I am a performance artist, a writer, a community worker. I facilitate drop-in programs for LGBTQ youth at Supporting Our Youth. That's me.
Oh my gosh, I totally forgot to say that I'm also part of Black Lives Matter. So I'm very proud to be part of Black Lives Matter Toronto. I'm thrilled to get to work with people like Raven and Leroy on the regular. So, what?
Squad, squad.
Awesome. Well, thank you everyone for being here. So we just kind of like gonna dive into it. The panel that we wanted to have for tonight was kind of just like something a little bit, not necessarily on the lighter side, but just like, I feel that we all kind of like love talking about, which is kind of the art and what it means to be an artist, if you know, as trans identified and non-binary people, and kind of like what we, this panel is just going to be kind of about like the experience that we go through and kind of just like what we feel is, you know, needs to be said, you know, just in terms of being artists and navigating spaces as art spaces as a trans non-binary artist. So kind of like just one thing that the first thing that I kind of wanted to ask all of y'all, like anything that you have to say about that topic. So right now with what's going on right now in the world, there's a lot of we're starting to see a lot of visibility in terms of our bodies as you know, as trans bodies, as non-binary bodies and people. There's this thing happening where we see a lot of visibility, especially for Black trans people, Black non-binary people who are most of the time visibilized in this. It can be in a positive light, or most of the time, even when it's in a positive light, it can end up being negative. So just kind of like what I wanted to just talk about is what do you think about this kind of like visibility, and how do you kind of like navigate this kind of like type of visibility, really, because it's kind of like people are. Or just kind of like giving us these spaces, but not really like doing the work to make those spaces, safe and available for us. And it's just kind of like a one-time thing, and you're there, and you're visible for that amount of time, but then we completely forget about you. So I just kind of like wanted to ask if you have had any kind of like experiences like that, or kind of like how you navigate, or if you have anything to say about something like that. Again, anyone can kind of just like go start. I don't know if you have anything you want to say about that, but yeah, it's kind of like the first thought.
I guess I would say that I don't know. Certainly, you know, I started my transition in 1999-2000, and there certainly is a lot more visibility for sort of mainstream white, sort of hetero or homonormative trans men. I think there's a lot more visibility than there ever was. I don't know that there's a ton more visibility for Black trans people compared to any other time in history. What we see around the visibility, or what I notice, is we see the visibility of a deceased Black trans body. That is what is hypervisible. So we are used to, it's almost as if you were only to go on the sort of the media and social media in terms of the number of times that, for example, Black trans women are represented, you would imagine that we are only represented within this space of not being alive. But in fact, we actually are alive, and we are trying desperately to survive and thrive. So I guess I would say I don't know that there is a ton more visibility. Having said that, certainly, one of the things that I think that is a bit different than, say, in 1999 or 2000 is that there's perhaps more of a possibility for us to be out as trans people in our home communities, and sometimes even in our families of origin, in ways that not only was it not possible, it was actively discouraged by the systemically transphobic medical community that encouraged people to change their names, move to a different city, and make up a past. I mean, I was just after that generation, and I certainly my peers at that time who had started their transitions before me had been encouraged to do that. So I think that that's a good thing, that we're able to sort of stay connected to our support systems and our communities. But I think we have a long way to go to having a whole prolific body of beautiful representations of trans people that are sort of, you know, really readily accessible. I have a young nephew who's a trans boy who's 9, and I think that, you know, he would probably be pretty hard pressed to find a lot of, just easily from a quick Google search, a lot of images or links to living Black trans people that he could connect to, which is too bad.
Yeah, I'll kind of jump on that a little bit. I think what I'm seeing a rise in is some visibility for Black trans women in television. However, those roles are still side roles. We're still in a place of fighting for the top spots, fighting for a lead role that has us as full human beings. I think we've been waiting for a long time to have representation that not only matters, but that is representative of the lives that we live. And so I see often there are stories of characters in stories like Orange is the New Black, for example, where Laverne Cox is a very beautiful, powerful person, and I think has used that platform to create a visibility in media that I wouldn't say wasn't there before, but not quite in the same way, right? But however, on the heels of that, you see a huge backlash. You see more movies being made about white American superheroes. And so you see this kind of pushback to these trans revolutionary folks. And I think that people are still so interested in our bodies and less in our like minds and what we have to offer and what we have to share and the ways that we have actually shaped the world that we're living in right now.
Yeah, totally. I think that's a very good point, talking about how a lot of us are just seen as just bodies and not, you know, it's just a body that you count, or like you made your quota, like you have one trans person there, that's good, like that's just the body and nobody cares about anything else. And as long as like you did your thing and like you leave us and kind of like that's a very good point, kind of like this erasure of anything else that makes us human, just like wanting just the body and exploring what that body is and not really, yeah. Does anyone have anything else to add about that kind of like the visibility and everything?
I can add to that. I agree with everything of what everyone's said so far. Excuse me. As someone who started like doing activism within like feminist spaces, and then eventually like queer spaces that were very like white or white passing, cis, you know, non-disabled, middle class, cishet, like women's spaces, I found that like there was a lot of tokenizing happening there, where like people were using like buzzwords like anti-oppression or intersectionality just as a way of like getting funding for something, and not realizing that these words are coming from like our communities and there's like real work behind those words, and it's not being used to center any populations like ours, like not centering like Black trans people. And so, you know, I see, and even now, like there's an influx of people who think that Black transness is cool and who, you know, want us to perform for $100 at their Black History Month event, right? As opposed to like centering us and making sure that our communities have access to resources. So it's a very like trans misogynistic, misogynoir, like essentialist, like, way of experiencing us and experiencing our bodies, right? Because some trans people are valued over others, right? And yeah, I feel like I know that because I fit, you know, within certain categories of acceptable transness, right? Like I get messages from these organizations or spaces that want me to perform and want me to bring my brilliance and aren't really prepared to like offer me sustainability. And I feel like a lot of like my Black trans friends are going through similar situations where like their bodies aren't valued, but like the art that they create and like the music that they make and all these things are being used and consumed and eventually they're just being thrown away. Right, so I feel like visibility, you know, and I don't know, I feel like visibility is a weird word for me too. It's kind of like inclusion. It's like, you know, we're already here, that you should be centering us as opposed to trying to like include us, like how like patronizing and paternalistic, right? And I feel like, what was I saying? I feel like like in order to make visible our experiences and like have like safe spaces for us to be visible and tell our stories and whatnot, we need to be like challenging these spaces to not only want us to be in the building, but to look at both the ways that they're complicit in anti-blackness and like contribute to that, the violence that happens to us every day, right? So, yeah, those are my thoughts on this building.
River, do you have anything to add on this?
I think there are definitely, I agree with every like one's point that was made. I definitely think there's also need to be more like visibility for non-binary people. Like I think it's great that we have Laverne, you know, and it's great that we have Janet Mock and everything, but like there's more visibility for trans men, non-binary people. I've definitely encountered situations where I'm only viewed as like, you know, the black trans person, you know, like, oh, great, we have you here, you're here, great, wonderful. And then that's kind of all I'm seen as. And it's really frustrating. So yeah, I think it would be amazing if we can really work on seeing like black trans people as full people, you know, and not just, you're black and trans, okay, that's all you are. Yeah.
Definitely.
Oops. Yeah, exactly. Like, and I guess like leading on the tip that a lot of people are talking about like being asked to do things only on Trans Day of Remembrance or Black History Month and being kind of like boxed into that. So like on the tip of tokenism, sometimes as trans artists, it's like you're allowed into a space to perform, but not really allowed to have the power in that space to help shape the discourse. For example, when trans feminine people have been let into gay men's spaces only as drag performers, but otherwise are shut out. And now with the internet, we see it happening in different ways, with the popularity of artists like Joanne the Scammer. So yeah, do you feel ways about this? Have you ever had that experience? How have you dealt with that experience?
Well, I'll go. So in the field that I work in, which is mostly contemporary dance, there isn't a conversation of trans bodies or any sexuality, really. And I feel like there's a long way to go within that field in terms of mindsets. I think it's a lot about mindset. And so when you go into a space, you often are the first trans person. And so you're educating someone all the time on how you want to be treated without ever getting to just be in that space, without ever getting to just walk into the space and know that you are who you are, they are who they are, and that's just what it is. Like there's this special category for trans folks or gender non-conforming or binary folks that we're in the corner of the room, we're not in the center of the room, and we're not in the center of the room because people sometimes don't even realize we're there. We have people don't even recognize that there's racism in Canada. We're still there, so you know what I mean? And so there's a very long road in terms of visibility, in terms of job security. It's hard to work as a trans person. It's hard for me personally to go into projects and to be my full self. I have to shave parts of myself for me to actually exist, for me to actually survive and make my rent, right? So to a certain extent, there are many people who I work with who have no idea about how I identify, right? And that's a partially a choice that I've made, but that's also partially a safety, because then they don't know what to do with you. If you can't tell that Cinderella story, that Sleeping Beauty story about the prince and the princess, and many of us can't tell that story, they don't know what to do with you. And because they don't know what to do with you, it's not a matter of them being like, oh, well, how do we figure out who's not in this space? A lot of it is about, so what do you think we need to do? How do we fix it? You're not here, how do we fix it? And instead of really self-reflecting on the things and the systems that make it impossible for us to exist in those spaces.
Yeah, that's all those are such great points. I feel that like I totally relate when you talk about how this you have to shed parts of yourself. You have to cover a lot of your layers in order to just kind of like be in space, especially even when those spaces are kind of like claiming to be, you know, like trans friendly or like whatever that's supposed to mean. Like you always, like as trans people, like there's really rare moments where like we can be, especially when it comes to like jobs and like working, especially if we're talking about like arts, if we ask to like perform or stuff like that, it's always just about the body. It's always just about you being there and not really disturbing anything. We're really kind of just like, my existence already is just, I'm disturbing, you know what I mean? I'm disturbing just by existing. So like, if I'm not allowed that space to just kind of like be my full complete self, then yeah, that's a problem, because that's again, it's always put on us to kind of figure out how to navigate spaces, even when we're told that those spaces are open for us, right?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I have an example. So I worked with a choreographer who I went to this audition and I was like, you know what? I'm going to show up as myself. I'm not going to put on anything. I'm not going to hide either. So I went and I was myself and I had my hair out and done. And after the audition, I got the role. And so he came to me and he's like, fuck with gender. And at first that seemed like this really endearing thing to hear, because I'm in this mainstream experience, right? So I'm like, wow, I'm being seen, I'm being recognized. And so this person is like, oh, well, I see these two sides of you. And I see how you do what people don't expect. And I like that. I want to create a solo for you. So each of the other people in the play had solos. There were 10 of us, 10 men. And so when the piece was being choreographed on me, he had me whipping my hair, which I do often and it's fine for me. But in certain contexts, it's not okay. And I didn't realize what he was actually making me do until I was standing in front of the other dancers and I was about to show my solo to them in a rehearsal, and he played the music for the first time. I had never rehearsed with this music, but it was fart sounds and effeminate sounds, like ooh, ooh, ah, ah. So every time I whipped my hair, it was a joke and there was a laugh track in it. And it wasn't about me laughing at society, it was about them laughing at me, like inviting a whole audience of strangers in fleck dance, like performance space, to laugh at me as the main joke. And so that's kind of an example of how people think that they're progressive, how they think that they're actually including you in the story when they're actually like capitalizing on the funny. You know, as Black people were funny, as Black people were entertainment, as Black trans women were even funnier because we're weird and we're, you know what I mean? And then gets to this like really strange sexual place where everyone wants to know what we do in our bedrooms, which is no one's business. But it all ends up playing out in how we receive jobs and how we receive and how we're safer shifted around in the hierarchy of your attractability to straightness, to heteronormativeness. The more you pass, the better. And that's a very complicated thing. There's so many trans people who are not out as trans, but who identify within transness, and we have the looks like, and can be very dangerous for all of us, really.
Thank you so much, Raven, for sharing that.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for sharing that. That is like appalling and ridiculous.
Yeah, I'm so sorry you went through that. That's ridiculous. Yeah, anyone else want to share about anything?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would say, you know, one of the things just to note for people who are watching who maybe aren't as familiar with our communities, that this is not a unique story. Like, that's the thing, is it is as horrific as it is, we all have these stories of profound, profoundly traumatic interactions with people who really don't understand, people who are really playing out sort of the systemic violence just through their day-to-day actions. Just on a bit of a different note, I mean, I worked at several very large art institutions, so I certainly was in a situation where I did actually have a lot of control over the decisions that I got to make on a day-to-day basis, and I got to make decisions that allowed other trans people, disabled people, Black people to be able to come and play, and we would make some pretty great things together. Having said that, one of the things that absolutely played out for me was that in most of the institutions that I've worked in, I am absolutely one of the only out trans people, and absolutely one of the only out Black trans people, and no question the only out Black trans disabled person, right? So the ways that I was engaged with, even in a decision-making role, well, first of all, Black don't crack. Also, trans men always look like we're teenagers. For the rest of our lives, we will always look 13. So I would, no one ever believed that I was 40. No one ever believed that I had been working there for, right? That I had been working there for, you know, 13 years, or, you know, in the university context for a couple of years. No one would believe that I would be the professor. Everyone would believe that I would be the student. So just the ways that assumptions about who gets to make decisions played out, that even when you have the authority to make a decision, you're still not seen as in that role, right? Because you're always already kind of unanticipated and not expected in that public space. So I think that's really been really challenging. One thing I did want to also say is that for me, I think the thing that has been the most challenging around this question is around disability. So as a Black disabled person in public space, we see what happens to Black disabled people in public space. It doesn't always end well, because it's just such an expectation by society that we're out of place. So I have found myself feeling very unsafe in work contexts, talking about or disclosing, or even just living my life and experiencing disability. That's been something that's been really challenging on top of my experience of gender and Blackness.
Thank you for sharing that, Cyrus. And,
thank you so much for sharing that.
Yeah, thank you for sharing, Cyrus. I wanted to touch on disability a little bit too. As a disabled artist, like, the most of my income comes from like performing and presenting and activating, you know, and there's this like common narrative within activist spaces that like if a place is harmful or like historically problematic, then we should boycott, we shouldn't perform there, we shouldn't, you know, engage with those things. And so it leaves like disabled artists who, Black disabled trans artists who have no other means of making money, you know, like with no, like for me, like I'll speak for myself, right? There are times where I would want to give up a gig because it's problematic, or I'd want to not perform at this venue because it has, you know, in context, it has a lot of problematic things happening there. But I can't, right? And I find that a lot of my Black trans disabled friends have the same sort of struggle, right? We know that it's happening. We're well aware of like the tokenization that is happening with us and how organizations and like other spaces are pitting us against each other and, you know, use their resources to further fund their own causes and their own communities and supporting ours. And it's hard not to feel guilty about that, right? But for some of us, it's not that simple. And so for me, I reconcile that, and I you know, often just think to myself that like this is about my survival, and forgiveness is something that, you know, like I really try to, okay, you know what, this is structural oppression, and like I need to eat, right? And yeah, like, I don't know, sometimes, you know, when I'm in like situations like that, like self-care or community care would be, you know, bringing someone with me so I don't have to deal with violent situations. But a lot of the time, speaking up means losing money or losing access to resources. So yeah, I feel like a lot of my Black trans, like disabled friends go through the same thing. Like, do we speak up about this really problematic anti-Black situation that's happening, or, you know, and go hungry, or do we shut our mouths and do what we have to do, right? So it's very complicated. Yeah, really complicated.
Thank you so much for touching up on that. That's a very, very good point.
Talk about it.
Yes, honestly, like just totally just spoke to me, and I think to a lot of people on the panel, in terms of just like the amount of things that we just like have to kind of like to be like, okay, like it's fine, like I'm just gonna block this and just act like this is not happening, even if I know that this is happening presently right now as I'm trying to convince myself that it's not happening, especially in terms of, you know, like as like artists, like trying to like make money off of like the art that we're doing, and most of the places that we're being offered to like kind of like go and like speak and like do our stuff and do our art and share our experiences are tokenizing us, right? And like, we know that process is happening, and we know that we are being tokenized, but you gotta eat. Right? So you kind of like you go with it. Yeah, totally rings.
Rings true. Have to make, like, I just want to stress that we all are making like a multitude of choices any time we agree to any artistic project. And I think that, you know, to some extent, there are certain things that are sort of overlooked. But when it's Black trans disabled people, it's like, oh, well, how could you have participated? You know, like, there's just an unfair expectation that we'd be the most, I just really resonated with what you're saying. And I think that there are artists make compromises all the time, and are, you know, activists make, there's all sorts of choices that we're always having to make. And rather than attacking or you know, pointing fingers or criticizing those of us who are, you know, more on the margins of Black trans communities, actually, you could like help me to get my bills paid, right? Like, if you don't want me to do the gig, show up in different ways. And I think that there are a lot more useful ways that we can help each other to survive and to be able to have the resources to both eat, pay rent, and create work that don't rely on us sort of attacking each other or criticizing our artistic choices. Because sometimes we have to make tough choices, and that's just part of what it is in this world. So I just really resonated with what you're saying.
Yes, me too. At the end of the day, we have to survive, right? We Black trans women, Black women, we hold down so much, right? We hold down every single revolutionary change, right? And so it's this interesting thing where we're always supposed to justify our wanting to thrive. Like, we're basically kind of trying to survive, and everyone is like, but not yet. You know, and so for me, I'm just like, I'm tired of playing that game. I didn't move here from Bermuda to not do what I came here to do. I didn't move here to repeat the process and the generations of poverty that so many of us come from. You know what I mean? I'm here to break those cycles. I'm here to change that in my life and other people's lives. So for me, what I've done is I created a dance company that allowed me and two other individuals, like, for us to just have a space to be ourselves, where we didn't have to define everything. We didn't have to explain ourselves to each other. We just got to be who we were. And in building that, I can't really go back to the other thing. And so I have walked away from lots of opportunities and lots of things. And now what I find is I'm getting what I want for myself. I'm getting what feels good in my body. Like, being a part of Black Lives Matter Toronto, for example, is a very powerful thing for me, to be myself, to be accepted as myself, to have the knowledge that I have, to walk in the shoes that I walk in, and to be a revolutionary at the same time, you know? We get to be all those things, and we get to eat. I don't understand why there's such this thing around real artists and sellouts, right? There's this kind of debate between the two. And it's interesting because everyone celebrates Nina Simone, everyone celebrates like India Ree and Lauryn Hill and all these people who are doing these things, because they don't know them. But because they have access to us, they get to shut us down. So we never get to rise to those places to make that kind of change, right? And so everyone will play Nina Simone when they want to get deep, but they don't want to talk about how she got there. She had to go through something to get to that particular place to be able to share her message, right? And so artists are people who show like possibilities for what a future can look like, right? And so we have to want more for ourselves. We have to take more than what people have allowed us to have, right? So that's just my take on that.
Do you have anything you want to say about this topic, River?
Yes, all of you, everything that was said was amazing, and like, thank you for like saying it, because it needs to be said. And I just thank you. That's all I have to say. I have nothing to add to it. It was just, yeah, I'm connecting with everything. Thank you.
Totally. Thank you so much. I think that one thing that you just said, Raven, that I think I also kind of like wanted to talk about and kind of just like connected in that sense is that idea that we're always told to wait, right? That idea that we're always told to just kind of like, yeah, like wait your turn, like it's gonna come, and like, oh, like what if you like expecting, like don't expect for people to understand you, like work with people, like get. But nobody else is asked that, right? Nobody else has ever asked to just wait for the life that they're inherently, you know, allowed to live. You know, it's just everyone just like keeps telling us just wait for your turn. But like, our turn has already arrived. Our turn is always here, and the wait for it's just. Are we allowed to live or not? You know, that's just like where it ends at. I think kind of like what we're talking about makes me kind of like think about what are ways that we can kind of like implement safe spaces for Black trans people and non-binary people to perform and share their work and do their work. I think that what I'm thinking about is in terms of like, because what we started this panel with was talking about visibility, and y'all gave a lot of really great points about what you think visibility means to you, and kind of like how you perceive visibility at this point in time in our society. So I feel that like right now there's like a lot, as we say, there's a lot of people wanting to kind of like tokenize us and like want to kind of like pluck us for their own benefit. So kind of like what are ways that when you are in those spaces, you like what are ways that you do to care for yourself and to kind of like maybe just like create boundaries for yourself? And also what are ways that I think Raven, you just gave one beautiful example that I think is creating just our own spaces, you know, just making our own things happen. I think that's one first step towards making space safer for us, but that also takes resources, right? That also takes a lot of resources and time. So which is something that most of us don't have. Kind of like, what are your ideas about what do you do when you are in spaces that you don't feel are there for 100% your benefit? And kind of like, what do you think should happen, you know, in terms of creating safe spaces and just more enjoyable spaces for Black, trans and non-binary artists to kind of express their work and do their thing?
I think,
go ahead, sorry.
No, after you.
I think that some of those spaces already exist. Some of those things are already happening. I think that there's often a feeling of powerlessness and often a feeling of this daunting task of doing something yourself. But you don't necessarily have to do it alone. Like, I worked with two other individuals who we grew together and we changed, danced together and we changed the conversation. Now there are stories on stage about queer people and about our lives and the homophobia that we have to face because of what my group has done, right? And so it just opens up a possibility for people to create it on their own kind of terms. I think it's like, as an artist, you are your own business. And so you have to think about how you strategically move through spaces to be able to create what you need. So if you're in these spaces, for example, that aren't seeing you but are paying you well, you take that money, you take those contacts, you move that to another space, and then you build, and you get a group of people together and you just run it. And that's how we kind of shake up the system and break that infrastructure, you know?
Totally. I think like one of the things that I have learned about creating safer spaces for Black trans people, again, has come through organizing with Black, Indigenous, people of color, disability communities around making art. The ways that we have created, like, I'm part of a performance collective called PDA, Performance Disability Art, and it specifically focuses on artworks and creation projects by BIPOC disabled artists. And, you know, just like there's ways that we create and build in self-care into the process of making the work so that it's not separate, it's not extra, it's not something that is solely the responsibility of one artist to be able to do. It's actually built into the fabric of how we make the work as a collective process. So sort of interrupting the expectations of how art gets created and then shown. You know, you could actually do it any way that you want. You don't have to do it in these super ableist, super transphobic ways, because if you're, you know, you actually do have choices. And so building that into the process so that it doesn't have to be on one person to say, actually, I need to take a break, or actually, it would help me if you didn't come covered in cologne or whatever. So that's one thing that I would say. The other thing I would say is that sometimes we don't have control over the kinds of environments that we're performing in, but we still are performing. And in those opportunities, as much as possible, squad, bring your people, squad up, go in a group, you know, perform collectively, perform collaborations. But even if you're doing solo work, make sure that you have your squad with you, because it really does make a difference to be able to look out and, you know, if you're someone who uses your eyes to see, but even just to experience or witness another human being that knows you and loves you in the audience, sort of there rooting for you, I think makes a big difference. I think one of the most fundamental things that I would say is make your fucking work. If you're an artist and you want to be making work, make your work. Don't let anything or anybody stop you from doing that, because we all get to survive and thrive. And part of how we do that as artists is by following our creativity and answering questions to our creative process. And so often we are prevented from making our work because of being told that our work isn't the right kind of work, or being told that it is not the right caliber, or being told that it's not right for this festival or whatever. And not to swear too much on this, but fuck that. Make your fucking work. Keep making your work. And I think that actually is one of the most important things that you could do. And then when you have an opportunity to present your work, really think about who the audience is. And if you're ever in a situation where you have the opportunity to speak to people who maybe need to be told some things, use that responsibility. And really, the larger the audience, the more mainstream the audience, again, squat up and make sure that you have a safe environment. But you need to spit some truth on there, because I think that there are opportunities that we have to make sure that we're holding the system accountable and that we have not forgotten that they are on notice. We need to remind them of that a lot. And sometimes we can do that through our practice in ways that they can hear that's a bit different than, you know, in another context. So I would say definitely to take that responsibility really seriously. Apply for grants, go on residencies, try to get funding in creative ways that are outside of the system, maybe use the underground economy, but make sure that you're giving yourself the time to make the work that you want to make, because you deserve to do it. And your work is probably amazing and beautiful, and there are other human beings on this planet that are going to get life, literal life, from experiencing what it is that you've created. Every one of the artists on this panel, I have been struck, like profoundly struck, by either hearing you speak or witnessing your work or watching you move and perform in front of an audience. I don't know what my life would be like if I hadn't experienced that. So I'm so thankful that you're making the work that you're making and that you keep doing that. And so to everyone else out there watching, make your work. Please, please keep making your work.
Can I bounce right in on that? There's this idea of scarcity, that there isn't enough. But there are literally lotteries that are hundreds of millions of dollars, you know what I mean? So it's kind of like this, right now we live in an age where you can have your own YouTube channel, you can get your voice out there, you can get your message or your story or your art out there. There's Patreon, there's a couple of different avenues you could take to share your message with the world. Not everyone's going to do it the same way. I'm not saying to do it the way that I just run, but something that is a benefit of being in this millennial kind of age is this this active attempt to create the jobs that aren't there for us. Now we get to create YouTube stars who are queer, who are trans. I see stories all the time on YouTube of people just sharing their coming out story, for example. I mean, I have feelings about that, but it's important that that people are sharing their stories and we are having more of these conversations and we're sharing more visibility. There's important that we have things like Instagram where people can be their own models and you can see more images of people like self-determining like who they are and how they want to be seen and how they want to be filmed, you know? And so we creating our own media platforms and our own kind of dance companies and our own art practices and our own theater groups is a part of that. Is a part of that change. And I feel like that is something that is already happening. So it's just continuing that work or tapping into it in a different way.
I co-sign to all of that. Like, preach, for real. And I also add to that, like, really pay attention to the people who value your work and want to pay for it. You know, keep them close, keep them in your networks, like let them know what's going on with you, like as Raven was saying. You know, social media is a powerful tool, right? Like for connecting us, the people who share our experiences and want to keep up to date with our travels and all of that, right? Like, I'm really big on social media as a way of, like, self-promotion. You know, like, I have a Twitter account, Instagram account, a Tumblr account. You know, like, I use my Facebook, my profile, my, like, personal profile on Facebook to only promote myself. Like, I feel like I needed that one space to only promote me, right? And also, people will make you feel bad or feel like, you know, you're self-serving or selfish for wanting to promote yourself and big up yourself and your work. And I would say to that, no matter what them people, right? Like, don't pay them any mind. Be proud of what you produce and talk about your accomplishments, even if it seems like, you know, it's like really, really small. You know, there are people out there whose experiences are similar to yours and who see the value in your work, and people also who see the value of supporting, you know, those of us on the margins, supporting like Black trans artists. And so, you know, talk about your work, share your work, you know, and make people pay for your labor, make people pay for your art, right? There's so many people who are talking about or expecting artists to eat off exposure, right? And we can't eat off exposure, right? So I think it's really important for us to big up ourselves and share our art and make sure that everyone knows how brilliant we are. So.
Go ahead, River. Did you want to add
something? I just wanted to add, in terms of like self-care, what I do is I personally like to reach out to my ancestors, angels, and they have guided me so much in my life and in my career. I just communicate with them on a daily basis. If I'm having any issues, any struggles, I just put it out there. And in whatever way, like, they support me, like, things happen. I believe in magic. So, yes, I encourage you to connect with your ancestors, if that speaks to you.
Magic is definitely very important. Magic has definitely helped me a lot. Did you want to ask any one more question?
Yeah, I guess people have talked about like the importance of connecting with other Black artists and other Black trans artists. And I'm wondering how much opportunity people have had to do that and like what that's meant to you and your practice, and also what people have been bringing up about their experiences with like both mainstream and alternative art spaces. And because of that, I guess like the desperation with which we create our own Black art spaces. And thinking about that, like a lot of our Black art spaces are under attack right now. And we've been having conversations about that a lot, about what happened at Blank Canvas Gallery, what's happening with the eviction of Koba Dance Studio, the funding of Wata Theater. And I guess like as Black trans artists, how do you fund your work in that cases? Do you have tips for other young Black trans artists on the come up, or not even young, other Black trans artists trying to navigate making beautiful work, surviving, and thriving in the city?
Whew, that's a big one. funding is a big task. And with my dance company, Ilnana Diversity Dance Company, what we did in the beginning is we worked with ArtReach Toronto has these kind of toolkits where you can look at how to write a grant. They also have like workshops on how to build your own like business platforms. They help you with taxes sometimes. Like it really kind of helped us figure out how to shape what we were doing, how to have a conversation and share like what it is that we want and where it was we're going. So I would say like defining your message is a good idea, thinking about what your brand is, and pushing that. And just asking. I think what I was doing 6-7 years ago isn't necessarily happening anymore. People aren't just spending their work through grants. People are also going to banks. People are also looking at sponsorships. People are also starting like crowdsourcing campaigns. There are people who are willing to support you if you believe that your work is worthy of that support. I think part of it is us accepting the fact that we deserve to have our work funded. And then the other part of it is just going for it. Like what Cyrus was saying, like write those grants, write those residencies. If they're not happening here in Toronto, because it's rough in Toronto, write a residency for Paris, go to Factory Theater and be like, hey, I have an idea. This is what I want to do. This is my collaboration. You can actually cut through all the bullshit and just go directly and ask for what you want. A lot of us don't even realize how much we can do by just going to it. For me, for example, like I can go to a theater right now and be like, hey, this is my idea, this is what I want, are you willing to support it? And theaters are often open to that kind of idea. Not that everyone's doing theater work, but just in my kind of field. So that's how I do it. I partner in co-productions. I reach out to folks who I know who have a little extra money. And then I keep those conversations going and keep those people in the loop on where my art is going and where it's and what I'm doing. I'm losing my eternity. It's like keep going after it. If you don't get a grant, find another one. If you can actually like volunteer to sit on a granting board, because that's free. You get to know like the ins and outs of how it actually works, and so you can write a grant that can be successful and be picked up. Yeah.
I would say also that, you know, maybe that's part of how the questions come together for me, is that, you know, there are ways that we, like, I mean, certainly, you know, as somebody who has moved more into a mid-career you know, experience as an artist, you know, figuring out how to offer the support that I can to help other people with writing their grants. Because I think that we need to ensure that if you're somebody who's getting a lot of grants, please help other people get grants, because, you know, it's just such a specific thing that isn't about just really know that if you're not getting grants, it's nothing to do with the quality of your idea, the quality of your writing. There's so many other factors that really have very little to do with you and your project idea. It has to do with just sometimes how things are organized in the document, or, you know, what else was being considered at the same time, just by chance, the year that you apply. So just getting support from other artists who have been through it, and helping artists, if you have been through it, to be able to get in there. You know, in addition, you know, you can apply to be on, as Raven said, on juries, but even, you know, apply to be on a consideration panel for one of the arts councils. One of the best ways to improve your grant writing strategies is by reading a whole bunch of other grants and figuring out which ones are successful. I think that for me, I would say that one of the things that that people don't often do, that they don't know that they can do, is that you can actually, you know, write or connect to call one of the grants officers at Canada Council or Ontario Arts Council or Toronto Arts Council and go and sit with them. And this is like part of what their job is that they'll, you know, you can go over your idea. You can ask, you know, what's the best grant for me to apply to? You know, I'm thinking of approaching it this way. Do you think that that's clear enough? And they'll actually help you through the process. And we don't often ask for help. I think that there's a lot of reasons. I know for me, I used to think that my idea wasn't shaped enough and I couldn't really share it. But in fact, actually, if you can articulate even a grain of it, it'll help, because you can get some feedback on how to tell the story. Because it's really just about how to tell the story in a way that other people who aren't familiar with your practice can understand it. So I would say help each other and ask for help. You know, that stuff is out there. But again, everything that Raven said, like, there's just so many alternative ways of resourcing our projects. And I think that I hope that for people who are moving into more arts administration or other kind of situations where they're able to control funding pots or you know, making decisions about exhibitions and stuff like that, that they're, you know, thinking through, you know, what representation, meaningful representation can look like, and making sure that they're doing programs. So if you're watching, making sure that you're programming, you know, Black trans women and Black trans non-binary and gender non-conforming artists and artists with disabilities, because it's really, it's actually essential at this point for you to remain relevant.
Yeah, and one other thing, because I forgot the first part of the question, which was around collaborating with other Black and trans artists and what that means. This panel, for example, is really very important, and it's a very, very big deal to me. There's so often you have to prove who you are, and I'm here sitting on a panel where I can actually say it and it's heard and it's not questioned, or I don't need to share our practices with each other and kind of what we've gone through in our pathways of survival and this collective idea of what needs to shift in terms of our representation as trans and non-binary folks. I think that helps me in my own practice. I'm a person who likes to work on my own, but I like to be supported by a group of other people. And so having regular conversations like this is part of that. I think you, Kim, and Leroy, starting this initiative to have more panels and have where Black trans folks are talking about how they live, how we survive, is a big deal. And I think it speaks to a level of change that can really happen around supporting each other.
Does anybody have anything they want to add to this? Go ahead.
I'll just add to this that with the last part of the question around the funding, I'm not very familiar with the grant system, really. But I am familiar with crowdfunding, because that's like one of the main ways I'm able to get resources in a short amount of time. And I think that it's really helpful, because it's a way of like us supporting each other and supporting the community economy. But I've often heard like really shameful, like capitalist ableist narratives around, like, you know, asking for money is shameful and selfish and like unnecessary. And I think that's bullshit, right? I think that so many of us support our art through crowdfunding, and I think it's a very like great skill to learn, like how to gain networks and crowdfund for like our arts. And I just wanted to say that, like, I'm tired of hearing these narratives around like Black people not sharing, you know, their suffering, or sharing that they're poor, or sharing that, you know, like they don't have money and they need to eat, right? Like, that's a narrative that like so many of us want to like keep close to us, because we don't want to be vulnerable. I see that as such a white capitalist colonial narrative, right? And I think that we're all entitled to wealth and all the well-being that money gives. And so, you know, the first part of that question, where, you know, connecting with like Black trans artists, like that's definitely my heart, right? Like, being able to connect with somebody, especially if you're performing and you're talking about what you're talking about, and like you hear that from the crowd, you might not be able to see the person, right? But you know that like they're there, or like having conversations afterwards with like Black and Black trans non-binary people, right? Like that is why I do the work that I do, to connect with community. As like a disabled artist, I deal with a lot of isolation. So I'm really thankful to be on a panel with all of you, you know, from the comfort of my home, right? Like I didn't have to drive nowhere, go nowhere, right? And we can have these really important conversations around like our artist practices and whatnot. I really, really value that. So thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I think we have one last question that we just want to wrap up with. It's just kind of like, I think that for all of us, I think that a lot of our art also constitutes a big part of our healing. Like we heal through our art practice and just sharing our art with people. I guess kind of if you could answer if that's something that you feel and that's an aspect you identify with, and also just if you want to maybe share one kind of like, because I feel like a lot of time when we talk about, you know, artists, especially like Black trans artists, when we talk about the performances, and also when we imagine, when people imagine our performances and our art, they kind of like imagine kind of like, it can be either like a very, they either imagine like something like funny and like, you know, not serious, or like the complete opposite of that, something very, very serious and something like that's like sad and like, you know, like doesn't really kind of like evoke any kind of like happy feelings. But so I just kind of like wanted to ask if you like to share maybe one moment where you kind of like feel very happy and feel that like you're enjoying yourself while you're performing, if you have a moment like that, or yeah, anything that you want to share about that particular thing.
Yeah, sure, I can go. I'll share something that happened for me. And Cyrus, you're a part of this. In 2008, my dance company, Ilana Diversity Dance Company, was asked to perform for Blockarama, which is part of Pride, but organized by Blackness, yes. And it was such an exciting thing to be asked to do, to be part of Pride. It was my very first experience of Pride. We worked really, really hard on this performance, and I performed Janet Jackson because she's my queen. Mm-hmm. And so after, when I watched the video back, and to give context, as a dancer, I'm always watching videos of myself before that moment. And I was always like, I always hated watching myself move or to see myself. And after I watched the video of that performance, it changed my life. At first I identified as a man who was wearing a wig and doing kind of a pseudo drag thing, because I wasn't really a drag performer. And I was like, that's me. That was the first time I really saw an image of myself that made me proud and that made me excited. And it really changed the way that I lived after that moment. And so having that opportunity that was given by Cyrus and Blackness, yes, to perform, like actually changed my life completely in the trajectory that I was actually going on. And so now I identify as Raven Wings, this transcendent two-spirit individual. And I'm not sure if I would have found her if I hadn't had that experience of a performance. And that really healed a lot of what was hurting inside of me.
Oh my, thank you so much for sharing that. I love that. Thank you so much.
I would say that for me, first of all, that's amazing, Raven. the first part around the artist healing, the work that I do absolutely is about trying to understand my life, I guess, as a disabled person. So a lot of the performance work that I do is relatively funny and self-deprecating about my experience in my life. But then the drawing work that I do is really large and is often done in this sort of ridiculous duration of 84 hours. I just take little breaks to sleep, and I'm kind of pushing my body and seeing what's possible. And I don't know, to me it's been very healing, because it's been, or cathartic, because I'm using my body as in ways that are really challenging. And it reminds me that my body is still here for me, even though there are times where it feels like we're at odds. So there's that. But then also my practice largely is about celebrating activist culture and activist lives. So it's sort of about a larger healing, a larger sustainability of how we can kind of be there for each other. So doing this project called Activist Love Letters, where people write letters to strangers who are doing organizing in different communities, just to say, by the way, here, I see you, I witness you, thank you. Here's what, I just wanted to tell you, I love you, and you know, you don't know me, but you know, you are amazing. So to me, this sort of using my art practice in the service of doing that has been really cathartic. And then when people write letters back to me and say, hey, you know, I got this letter from a stranger and you're a stranger, can you get this response back to them? It's really been so amazing. So I'm very thankful that my practice has allowed me to play in that way. And then in terms of my favorite moments on performing, I have like a generalized anxiety disorder. So like, most of the time, right before I perform, I'm usually, if it's like on a stage or something, I'm waiting in the wings and like I know that my turn's coming up next and every part of my body that can sweat is sweating. And I actually usually in that moment think, I could just run. I could just leave. I could just run in the other direction. I could be home in like 20 minutes. Like probably no one will hate me. Probably I'll get booked for another gig in the future. Or maybe I can just go home and die inside under my duvet. I think about that every single time. There's not one single time that I've performed where I haven't thought I should just make a Cyrus size hole through that door. I'm going to run. And then right in that moment when I'm fantasizing about what it would be like to bolt, I hear them say, okay, Cyrus Marcus Ware. And I go on stage. And so my favorite part of is not one moment, but I guess it's those moments, because if I actually push forward and actually get on the stage, usually with dry, pasty, scared mouth, I remember that I actually love performing. And in that moment, I'm like, oh, actually, this is why I keep doing it. Because in the wings, I'm thinking, why the fuck do I keep signing myself up for doing this kind of stuff? I should be alone drawing in my studio. No one's there. There's not people looking at me. It's fine. There's burgers. There's fries. It's good. But I usually forget about it until I'm in the wings, how nerve-wracking it is.
Oh my God, bless you so much. Thank you so much for sharing that.
Wow, you would never know that, Cyrus.
Thank you so much.
I mean, like,
I could share a favorite moment. So for me, I grew up as a very shy kid. And one thing I always, and when I started dancing, my mom was the one who kind of took me to my first dance class and like helped me and supported me. So she would always be to the top left corner of the theater. I don't know why, but she always sat in the top left corner. And so she passed away a few years ago. And I found a new way of connecting to myself in moments when I was nervous on stage. There's always a moment within a performance that I'm doing that I'm really nervous. I get to a place of being like, wow, people are actually looking at me. People are like, did I go too far? I'm not sure about this moment. And I look over to the left and there's always usually a little light over there. And so for me, that's my favorite moment. My favorite moment is connecting to that spirit of confidence and support that allows me to kind of do what I love. And it's also something about performing in dance. However, dance is realizing that it isn't just my experience. When I walk away and I realize that other people have experienced, have gone through it with me, at that it feels like I've done my job, like I've told the story and that someone connected to it and I healed from it and then and they're healing from it. So that's kind of what it is for me, yeah.
Oh, that's so beautiful, Raylan. Oh, it's so true. Like I find it's just a release, you know, when you release all the emotions, all of the pain, all the struggle. I think most of my work has been about, you know, finding my voice and constantly rediscovering myself and healing through words, movement. I don't have a particular favorite moment. I think each moment I'm on stage, I just try to be as present as possible and connect with the audience. So I think that's just really my favorite moment, just being able to connect with the audience and people in the crowd and feel energy and exchange energy. Currently, I'm doing something where I meditate, and I'm kind of like channeling and communicating with my ancestors and spirits and stuff like that, and using that to kind of inform my work. And it's really powerful, and I'm really enjoying this new process I'm on. And so, yeah. But I wanted to share that.
I'm excited to see that. I really want to see what you come up with that. I hope we will get to witness that in the near future.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks everyone for sharing your really beautiful moments. And I think one of the moments that really stands out for me was the first time that I performed after, it was about like 4 years ago, 3 years ago, after I developed chronic pain. And so this was the first time that, and like Cyrus, like what you were saying around like generalized anxiety disorder, I have that layer on PTSD onto that, and I'm a nervous wreck before performances. I'm so nervous. And you know, so I'm nervous, I'm in pain, and like I have this really like racially charged, angry poem that I want to perform. And so I get up and I perform, and it's been a long time since I've performed. And you know, my eyes lock with another non-binary Black person in the crowd, and we come together, and you know, this person and I share a hug and a cry. Because like it's, you know, like our experiences are so similar, and yeah, it was really, really intense and beautiful. So that's definitely one of my favorite moments. And yeah, I think that my art, I heal through my art every day in every way. It's a tool for my survival. It's, you know, my protection against like oppression and anti-Blackness. And it's a way that like I celebrate, you know, my past, present, and future self. So yeah, it's definitely, I find a lot of healing in art, and I find a lot of healing in making art with other people. And I find a lot of healing in sharing art with people, like, you know, IRL, PRL. And I find a lot of healing in, you know, like in art, Black art. So. Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much for sharing, Links. That was that's a really beautiful moment. Yeah, I think that's pretty much it. I thank you so much, everyone. I feel so overwhelmed by the fact that you all were here sharing that with us, and we're here all together. That was a really beautiful moment. Thank you so much. Honestly, I just can't even.
Thank you again so much for organizing. And I also just wanted to shout out and say thank you to the people who are following along, and the people who were tweeting along. We really, like, it just made for such an engaging discussion. So thank you for doing that, folks at home. And thank you to both of you for organizing. And honestly, the rest of the panel, like, what a dreamy evening. What a great way to spend my night. Thank you.
Honestly.
Yes, thank you so much. It was a wonderful conversation. I'm excited to continue to have conversations with all of you. Yeah, I really appreciate being able to share and learn and hear and heal through the conversation. Thank you.
Thank you all. I think we just, go ahead, everyone. Just say your last words before we all go.
Yeah, I just wanted to say thank you so much, both of you, for organizing this and inviting me. Thank you to all the beautiful and wonderful panelists. Some of your work I wasn't familiar with before, but I can't wait to further explore all the wonderful things that you have coming up. Thank you for making this a very accessible experience for me. For sure. I really appreciate the fact that this was an online panel and people were able to experience this and will continue to be able to experience this at home, and that we're transcribing it. And, it's so good to me. It feels so good to me to be able to be a part of this. So thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much. Please support Black trans artists. Buy our stuff, buy our art, go to our shows, whatever way you can support us, please support us. Thank you.
Yeah, I second that. Please support Black trans artists. Please support Black lives, all Black lives. I hope that all of you who have been watching will continue to do great things, that we will continue to move and shift the conversations of trans and non-binary folks from cis straight narratives to from our mouths and our bodies. Thank you all so much.
Mm-hmm. And if you're out there doing, if you're a programmer, if you're designing exhibitions, if you're programming stage shows, to really, really show up, show up in great ways and make sure that you're representing the diversity of Toronto and Ontario, because we are that. Share the resources and please remember that there are other months also outside of February. And it's great to actually be programmed many other months, like the other 11 of them. And also that you don't, it's actually really quite simple to engage with the brilliance of Black trans artists in the city. There's great lists out there. You really don't even have to do that much work. Just please do it.
Tell it.
Talk about this. Yes. Thank you so much. That's the perfect last word. That's the perfect, this other month in the year. There's 11 of them to be exact. Totally. Thank you so much, Cyrus, Lynx, River, and Raven. Thank you so much for being part of this panel. So this was the first episode, the first panel of Black Trans Living Month. So we'll be having other panels throughout the month. I think hopefully the next one we're trying to get it scheduled, get it out there for next week. So stay tuned. The event page will have all the listing and the timing for the next panel. We'll let people know in advance, more in advance than this one, definitely.
Yeah, and if you want to do your own read, it doesn't even have to be one topic's on the page, but if you just have something that you want to speak on, you're also welcome to do your own read.
Definitely. Just if you need help setting up anything, if you need help having your live video just broadcasted or whatever and shared, definitely reach out to us if you want to do any kind of panel live read on with your friends, or if you want us to help you finding people to do a panel with around this discussion about Black Trans Living Month. And so just hit us up at blacktransliving@gmail.com. If you have any questions or any suggestions or want to have your own panel being part of this, it's Black Trans Living Month, all in one word, at gmail.com. So, yeah. Thank you so much. And thank you to our panelists, our beautiful, beautiful panelists. And we'll be posting this video on all our pages. And so yeah, you can revisit this video as often as you want, and you can also share it with your friends. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye for now.
Bye.